Rawr.
Ma.
It's Black Panther.
No, it's not. Please go away. What is up, yo? How are ya? I hope your week was chill. So you probably noticed that there's a lot of metal in this channel, and that's for two reasons. One, I love metal, so yeah. And two, metalheads tend to go the extra mile when it comes to, well, everything. So naturally, there are a lot of examples coming from that genre. But in my attempts to not make this a metal-only channel, I try very hard to find cool rhythmic ideas in other genres as well, even though I might not know them as deeply. That's where you guys come in with your epic suggestions. So thanks, and I finally get to talk about some film scores sent to me by Mr. Douglas Blumeil. Thanks, man. Today, we'll take a look at two examples by Swedish composer Ludwig Goransson. So let's do this. We'll start with the Wakanda theme from Black Panther. This theme has a lot to do with rhythmic masking. Check it out. So usually in, I don't know, 92% of music, it's more common to spot a time signature change rather than a subdivision change. So if a song is in 4-4 and 16th notes, for example, I find it more likely that the time signature would switch rather than the subdivision suddenly shifting to triplets. And God knows how bad they are when they're played simultaneously.
Oh, hell no!
Anyway, there's a reason why you barely hear stuff like this, because 9 times out of 10, it sounds bad. Well, maybe 8 out of 10, if you include that Textures song.
Yo, that riff is so good.
Anyhow, when attempting to do this, you'd most likely have to think about how to mask those unwanted flams. And Ludwig had managed to nail it, so here are a few things to notice in this theme. It starts with a few talking drums playing a groove. Now, first of all, when dealing with percussion-heavy music, like Latin or African traditional styles, flams are an essential part of the sound landscape, due to the fact that more often than not, these grooves are played by a group of percussionists and not one player. So by working with an African-influenced theme, flams on the percussion end are more than welcome. Second, listen to this groove. It has two parts. The second part has 4 notes, so I'll write it as 16th notes. And the first part has 3 notes in it, and I can write it in one of two ways, either like this or like this. The differences are slim. See if you notice. Takata, takata, takaka, takaka,
takata, takata, takaka, takaka. This tiny difference is very easily missed, especially when played with this African-style flavor to it, where the subdivisions aren't rigidly even to begin with. It's not like in pop and rock, where nowadays every single note is carefully quantized just to achieve this fake sense of perfection. Rather, the subdivisions here are loose and flexible, kind of elastic. So this is another way this discrepancy is masked.
Then the horns come in, playing this figure. To be honest, the first time I listened to it, I automatically assumed these are the downbeats. As if this figure was played twice slow and once faster. Slow, slow, fast. Slow, slow, fast. But it's not. The horn notation looks like this. So this spans over 2 bars of the percussion groove. And the cool thing to notice is this note right here, that correlates with either this one or this one. The horns are strictly playing 16th notes, which make the percussion sound more like this version. As for the first bar, the horns are playing triplets, which pulls the percussion towards this version, but we can't really hear them that clearly. The last thing to notice is this line. Now, if that's not the musical equivalent to the word triumph, I don't know what is. This motif clearly has triplets at the end, where everyone else is playing 16th notes. But listen to that huge orchestral sound. The attack on those notes is so wide that these triplets kind of soar over the structure in an overarching way that doesn't really clash with the 16th notes. These different attack qualities make our ears forgive this abomination. If all the attacks were short, it would sound like this. And aren't we lucky they aren't? So that, plus a great use of sidechaining, all makes this epicness even smoother.
Ooh!
Terrible!
Bad!
Not bad!
Well, pretty good!
Okay!
Decent!
Fair!
Great!
I loved it!
Good!
By the way, I don't know if he sat there and actively thought about these things in this way. But I mean, he's an amazing composer, so I'm sure this makes sense to him in one way or another.
Great, one down and one more to go. Yet another movie this guy composed the music for is TENET. And as much as I claim to be good with time manipulation, I have no idea what's going on in that movie's timeline, but we're not talking about that, are we?
The main theme of this movie is a great example of what happens when the guest is way too dominant and overshadows the host.
The host was just consumed.
If you have no idea what I'm talking about, check out this video.
So, we start off with some reverse orchestral stuff, and soon enough, this thing happens. To my ears, these hits are the boundaries of our framework. So that's where everything restarts. So basically a glorified beat one. And then these emerge. These sound like this. And these hits are supported by the arpeggiator that creeps in what sounds like sextuplets. Also, there's a big gap till this pattern repeats. Big enough for us to lose track of any pulse we've managed to pick up. But if we try and follow that pulse, this is what happens. To make a long story short, this is how I hear it. So, the host is 4-4, well, 4 bars of 4-4, and the guest is 3, both 3-8 and 3-16.
3 is a charm!
The host here is only supported by the overall beat count. And yes, I know that I've said before that the beat count alone isn't enough for it to be considered a 4-4, but I just can't unhear it that way, even though there are no instruments that are indicating that 4-4.
Maybe I've been listening to Meshuggah too much.
Anyway, I want to show you the various ways that he makes the 3 side, the guest, stronger. So the hits in 3-8 are number 1. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1. That arpeggiator is number 2. There's this 3-16 guitar line that's number 3. There's this section that has nothing but the 3, so it only resolves to 4-4 at the very end. But the peak for me is this riff here. Did you hear how dominant the 3 became? You can barely find the 4.
Maybe he was listening to Meshuggah too much. I mean...
And before this riff, we get our first musical element that supports the host, the 4-4. Check out this rhythmic pattern.
Also, there's a YouTube breakdown video that he did about this film where he clearly states that he wrote it as 3-4, 3-4, 3-4, 3-4, and 4-4, which is equal to 4 bars of 4-4, but, I mean, he wrote it, so he gets to decide. And even so, I still can't hear it not in 4-4. And by the fact that he has a signature Meshuggah guitar behind him,
bruh,
and there's that section in the score that mysteriously sounds like bleed, I wonder if he just wrote it in 3-4, because it will be easier to read. We'll never know. Unless I reach him somehow. Epic stuff, Mr. Goransson. Goransson? Wow, it's so hard to pronounce.
By the way, if any of you understood the timeline of that movie, and you have a camera, please just make a time-consuming video for me about it. I really didn't get it. I guess I'll see you next week, or I'll see you last week. Oh, also, I have to mention this section. It's just fives, nothing fancy about it, but it's fives in a blockbuster movie. That's pretty cool.